Welcome to In the Loop with Laura. Today I am honored to have Kathy Brunnick on the show with us. I've recently met Kathy at a spinning group at Crete's Hut. Is this what we call it?
Crete's Spinning Hut,
just outside of Winnemac, Indiana. Dina Gottschalk told me about it. She lives in town and she's a wonderful spinner. Ask her about it sometime when you see her at First Federal. And I've been there, and Kathy is just a master of both spinning and of knitting, and she has brought amazing things to share with us today. What we're talking about right now is doilies, but first I want to know a little bit about you. How long have you been knitting?
I started knitting when I was 9.
Okay, and where was that?
That was in Chicago.
Okay.
And a neighbor taught me how to knit because she couldn't decipher crochet patterns, and I could. So I would explain the crochet patterns to her, and she'd give me her leftover yarn, and she taught me to knit.
And so you were teaching her at the age of 9.
Well, I wasn't
teaching her. Deciphering, you were telling her what?
Yes. She was a fantastic crocheter, but she did not understand the patterns written out.
The shorthand.
Yes. So once I explained them to her, she knew how to go,
and
she just did it.
And I want to point this out to people who are watching. You don't know when you share a craft with someone, even if it's not textiles, if it's woodworking or painting, and you are sharing something that gives you joy with people around you, children, how that's going to go on to influence their lives. Because Kathy was sharing with me how when she was older and she and her husband were having the discussion, should she work outside the home or not, how when she did stay at home, some of this crafting is what basically kept you grounded. Is that correct?
Yes.
And she was primarily weaving at that point?
I was spinning and weaving.
Okay. How did you start out spinning?
I saw an ad in Workbasket magazine
for
a drop spindle and a pound of fleece from Texas. And so I sent in and ordered it, and it came back, and that started the mania.
Oh, my goodness. So when that happened, they gave you just written instructions? You figured out how to spin by reading something and dropping the spindle quite a lot, I imagine.
Yes. It's very simple because you're just twisting. And one of the suggestions was to just get a dowel and put a hook on it and just twist and see how you would elongate the twist. Mm-hmm. And then take it from there and put it onto the drop spindle and just started.
Wind it up.
Yes.
But I can see how that, I do spin, so I know how that works and how it would work, but that you had the stamina to read it and figure it out without another human is really remarkable.
I've always been better at learning to do something by myself just from written instructions.
Well, seeing the kind of lace that she has moved into, that is obviously very handy that that's the way you learn, because we'll look at some of these books in a minute. But first, I want to point out some of these lace doilies that Kathy has created. These two here, we will look at closer. They are both made out of cotton thread, but the one that I have lying flat, this one right here, is out of her hand spun. And you can see, I'll move this up here, just from this one single thread, how fine her spinning is. And this is a double ply.
Yes.
And the wool that you spun this out of again?
That is rami, or known as China grass.
Okay, and you did not own this particular sheep.
This was not sheep. That is a plant.
Okay, you said what grass?
It's China grass.
Not familiar with that.
Yes.
And it happens.
It's very white on its own.
Okay,
it
that's what I was going to ask.
It grows about 6 foot tall, and they pull it out by the roots, and then they process it. And if you were in one of the Oriental countries, you would see a lot of it because it's grown, it grows sort of on the order of bamboo, that it does not require a lot of care or pesticides or anything. And they process it, that they use it where it's very long. When we get it here, it's been chopped up into pieces and made into roving. And because of our spinning equipment can't take very long fibers.
Otherwise, you would have to spin it similarly to flax?
Yes, yes. And see, we don't spin commercially. We do not spin flax. And most of the flax that is spun here, again, is cut into manageable size
Interesting.
Pieces.
I didn't realize that. Yeah. So with flax, I know it works better with wet spinning. Is it similar with this?
There's no. You can spin it wet, but you don't have to. You do not put this on a distaff. You generally, because you're spinning it from roving, what you do is you hold it in your lap again, and you have to lengthen it out and make it smaller from the roving. And if you tried to use any kind of spinning oil or anything on it, it would only make it gummy or sticky. So it's better because you do want it to slide against, you know, relatively easily against itself.
So did you spin a greater amount, or you was it difficult and you spun just a smaller amount?
It was just a sample.
Yeah.
I wanted
okay.
to see how it would work, if I could do it. And so it worked out. But I, because I didn't feel that the roving was worth spinning more of it, I just stopped at that amount.
Okay, and made the smaller doily.
Yes.
Well, let's look at it a little bit closer again. And spinning or knitting lace.
Yes.
You begin at the center.
Yes.
Did you begin with the crocheted magic loop?
No.
Okay.
You start with a knitted type loop. Which you facilitate with a crochet hook, but it's really that you're knitting it on.
Right. Is it the Emily Ochler?
No.
This,
a magic loop is a little different than Emily Ochler's.
Okay. Okay, so you begin at the, so when you're knitting lace, and I imagine most of the people who are watching this, it's just beyond what you can even imagine. Some of you might be knitters. And is lace knitting hard?
No.
Okay, it's not. Okay.
What you have to learn is that you do things.
Okay, here's an
much by row by row.
Let's
and as
this.
You can see.
This is how she sets up when she sits down to knit something that's difficult. And we'll turn it around here. You've got your own.
Yes, this is the beginning of this doily. And as you can see, I've started it in the center, and to start it, I used five needles, four that the pattern was on, and the fifth to knit.
Okay.
And what you have to do is you have to go row by row, and I keep track. You write every row down.
Yes.
You never think that you're going to remember it,
yes.
because if you leave this for 2 weeks and come back to it,
right.
you know exactly where you're at. You mark every repeat with a marker. My pink marker, since it's brighter than the rest of them,
is your beginning of row?
Is my beginning. And then you count. You learn that as you work this, you count every section, every repeat.
Right.
And if one is wrong, then you know when you're going to come back and do your plain round, you need to correct. You have to find out where that error is and correct it.
Right. So somebody who is going to try lace knitting needs to be someone who feels confident in knitting, confident in, and this kind does take concentration. You're not going to have small children around because you do have to count. But it's repetition. You're doing the same repeats over and over and over again, and you've probably are experienced enough that you've made all the different knitting mistakes, dropping stitches and picking up things by mistake and misplaced yarn over, so that when you come back to that section, you can look at it and not be freaked out and correct.
After you get a little experienced with lace knitting, and as you're knitting it, you will realize as you look at the chart, you can see that all the overs should line up.
Yep.
If they don't line up, mm-hmm. you know you've made a mistake.
Right.
Something is wrong, and then you have to go back and correct it. Mm-hmm. Now, some people are good enough that you can drop stitches down and come back.
Nice.
Otherwise, if it's really a really bad mistake, mm-hmm. then you have to rip. You just have to go back. And as you rip, you count the rows that you're ripping. So every time you go around once, you go, okay, that was 90, and now we're on 89, now we're on...
Mm-hmm. And I'm sure writing that down is very helpful.
Yes.
Because you can't, don't rely on your memory.
No, you just cannot remember. You will never remember.
There's so much going on with the pattern and time and the counting that you just have it on automatic. And one of the nice things for people who have not knit with charts again, perhaps that's even the way that you're going to start. A chart, and this is a, I can see this. This is a wonderful little setup you have here. So she has this so that she can set it up as a desk?
Yeah. And it's wide because this pattern will eventually, when I finish this, it's going to be two sheets wide. So that's why I have the extra piece of paper.
Now, for people who create designs like this, they have always in the copyright that it is just fine to photocopy charts for personal use.
Yes.
And that's exactly what this is for.
Yes.
You don't want to have your full book here, marking in it, or having your book open. It's just not going to work.
No.
You make a photocopy, maybe two. I have friends who travel, and they'll make two and put one in one bag, one in the other, so they don't lose. And then each of these symbols stands for something. Yarn overs, knitting two together, here's
the key.
You have
your key to symbols, and as long as it's in English, it's relatively easy.
Okay, let's take a look at a German one here.
Well, this is the... this is Patterns by Herbert Niebeling, and it is the first... one that they came out with, that they're republishing some of the patterns. And as you can see, since I've worked one of the doilies.
Look at that. That is beautiful all in itself.
That's one of the charts.
Is that the pink
one? Could be, I'm not sure.
Okay, we'll pull some of these out.
Oh, but you can take out they send you a leaflet that shows the patterns.
And then this is...
And it's all in German.
All in German.
Yes. And so as you go through it, you pick which one you want.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to go to the charts, which are on large
sheets. I'm glad
these
are in charts. Some of the really old lace is written out.
Yes. It's much easier. Well, all the German patterns were charted.
Oh.
Herbert Niebeling started actually writing patterns in probably about the 20s, and he charted everything because he really didn't knit. But he was able to, just in his mind, come up with the patterns.
Really? I did not know that story about it, because I'm very familiar with his name. So here is an example of, is this Niebeling?
Yes, this is
this
Niebeling.
This is one of his patterns that she's talking about. I'll just give you the close-up, and then we can go to a wider view. But you've got these beautiful oak leaves.
Yes.
He's created in a knitting pattern of, all that is increasing with yarn overs and decreasing and having very strategic increases that create a circle.
Yeah. And he was known for this mesh background.
So let me hold this up here. Can you grab onto the other side? We'll see.
And these are small tablecloths. This one is called anemone.
Hmm.
Why? I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
and some of them he didn't name. Some of these names are names that have been given to them.
Hmm.
Yeah, so.
That's just gorgeous and gorgeous work. Yeah. And this is just out of a cotton thread.
Yes, that's out of size 20 cotton thread.
Size 20 cotton thread, and I have crocheted with that before. We have one other doily to share with you, also out of size 20 yes. cotton thread.
Yes.
Here it is.
And this again is a kneebling. And my fascination is always the flowers and the leaves.
Well, that's I really clever with the multiple decrease there. It's almost
yes.
like a pre-noop.
Yeah, he really designed very, very well. There is nobody that I know of that has designed doilies that comes close to his work. England is very good, but his patterns do not compare with kneebling. Mm.
So this meshing.
Yes. It's a knit to yarn over, double yarn over.
Right.
And so it's, his patterns tend to be very hard to block because, like these, there's a lot more stitches in these leaves than, you know, so they don't block flat. But that's part of the charm
right.
is this bumpy look.
Right.
Because it gives it texture.
Mm-hmm. Some 3D dimensionality.
Yes.
So blocking, again, is what you do at the end of a
yes.
piece of work. As you saw in this piece,
yeah.
I don't want to.
You can.
Okay. In this piece, this is actually what it looks like
when you
as Kathy is knitting it. It looks like a little piece of
string.
It's not
all
a flattering
string.
Not a flattering look.
No.
And when you first do lace, you're thinking, oh my goodness, I'm doing it wrong. Why does the one in the book look mine doesn't look like that? Well, it's a little bit like ramen noodles. And when you're done and you cast it off, it doesn't look any better, and then the magic begins.
Yes.
Do you soak or do you spray?
No, I always wash because as you work, mm-hmm. you're going
your
to get
oils.
The oils from your hands on the thread. And the center tends to always get a little darkened.
Mm-hmm.
So you're always trying to get that little mm-hmm. bit of soiling out of it. And it relaxes the thread to mm-hmm. make it easier to stretch. And I stretch them. I have foam mats.
Okay.
And it just depends on the size as to how many of these mats I put together. And then I use glass head pins.
Oh.
Because every loop is pinned.
Each of these loops.
Each loop. So on the large ones, you have a whole lot. And if you didn't have glass head pins, your fingers are just tore up. So.
Oh, I use the T-bars. Is that...
Well,
they're too expensive once you get some.
Well,
so many
when you get into the large ones, yeah, the T pins, yeah.
Too many.
So
it's wet. Do you starch it?
Yes. You use a light spray starch. Now, some people do much heavier starching mm-hmm. than I do, but I find that just a light. And the starch helps to facilitate
mm-hmm.
the stretching because mm-hmm. as you're doing it, it's drying.
Right.
These tend to dry very fast.
Right.
So the added a little bit of spray starch does help to keep it damp.
And then you put the pinhead in and
yes.
pull it out and you
yes.
like put the corners in first and then work
well,
in between?
What you usually do is you first divide it in half. Then you divide it to quarters,
mm-hmm.
then you divide it to eighths, and after you get it into eighths and you're satisfied that it looks right,
uh-huh.
then you come back and you start pulling your individual ones.
Right.
And some you have to go back and adjust often, you know. And as they store, they tend to just
relax
get,
into
yeah.
the way that they
yeah.
want to be, which we all do, don't we?
You got it.
We have two other books that I want to share that she brought about lace knitting. The first one, I wonder if our library even has this one. She is
well known. It was the first book that I used
mm-hmm.
in doing doilies, and it's very self-explanatory, has very good explanations. She talks about markers and
let's take a closer look at it. This is called The First Book of Modern Lace Knitting by Marianne Kinzel.
Yes.
And she has four or how many of these?
Just two.
Is it just two?
Just two. Yes.
So she is also a German lady. The Germans really have the corner market on the
yeah.
the fine lace.
England was German too. So. And these are reprints.
Yes.
These were first published, I believe, in the 50s. So, and she starts out with giving you...
That's nice.
Charts and the, you know, explanation of all your symbols.
Right. And she it looks like some easier designs at first.
I found that, for me, knitting in the round was easier than knitting back and forth.
Because you always have the right side facing.
Yes, yes.
And here's some settee backs.
And a lot of people think, why do you knit lace? Because it's so old-fashioned.
Uh-huh.
But it is the fascination with the patterns. This was...
Can you go back?
Yeah, I think there's one here.
Oh, that's beautiful.
This was the first... Aww. These were the first ones that I made. And when I go back and look at them, they're naturally full of mistakes.
Uh-huh.
But by making... I made two small ones and a large one,
mm-hmm.
it gave me the experience. And then mm-hmm. because I wanted to enthuse one of my friends to start this lace knitting, because her and I had a talk, and she was actually a better knitter than I did the next one, which was the leaves, and I gave it to her as a present. And because she said, well, if you can do it, I can do it. So she now too knits. She doesn't knit as much as I do, but mm-hmm. she knits also.
We all have a special interest that just
yes.
somehow sits with us
yes.
nicely. And obviously a lace knitting
yes.
and spinning and weaving have
yes.
all been that particular niche for you. But I agree that if have another friend and
yes.
I'm challenging you right now, I think you can do lace knitting.
Yes.
I think you can try it. And if you don't like it, that's fine. You go on and
that's right.
find what else that is
yes.
that you like. But don't be intimidated by a clever placement of holes.
No, no. It's not intimidating at all once you get into it.
Yep, and it's wise that you started with a small.
Yes.
Small project, don't commit yeah. to
don't,
a blanket.
Don't try to do a tablecloth to begin with. Start with something small. And you don't have to do doilies. You can also do other things that are lace. You could do mm-hmm. a collar or mm-hmm. or you could do just like a little kerchief or something that will just give you a taste of the lace.
You could do, as Marianne Kinsell points out, do a placemat.
Yes.
Which would be going back and forth. And the reason why that's different, just to be more clear, is that when you're knitting on the right side, you're looking at the pattern, and when you turn it around, then you have to purl, usually in patterns, or knit, depending if it's garter. But it's going to be the opposite side. You're going to be working it
yes.
in some manner. So with these are all knit. Oh, okay.
Yes.
All your work you do, you're knitting, you don't have garter stitch for the most part?
Not in doilies.
Okay.
Not in doilies.
But in shawls.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I am so thankful that Kathy came and joined us and shared a wonderful gift she has with circular lace knitting and just the little taste that we've had of the flowers and the other things. I hope that you have been intrigued and challenged, and thank you so much for coming.
You're welcome. Glad to do it.
Welcome to In the Loop with Laura. Today I am honored to have my aunt, Nancy Ricketts, on with me. We were just at a family reunion that my father-in-law, Mike, and Jane Ricketts put on in Manitow Park. And Nancy shows up, and she has these, and she says, okay, everyone, go ahead and grab them. Big R for Ricketts, reunion 2014. And I said, Nancy, come to my show! So she has, I had no idea. She's got this interest and now has a new embroidery machine.
My husband, Will, we picked up it's a Quattro 2 Innovus, and it's an embroidery sewing machine.
Okay, and it sounds quite fancy. I know some of you have a sewing machine and you've been slobbering to get an embroidery. Some of you have gone to Winning Edge and you see the fun things that they do. And
right.
Nancy, what is it that first caught your eye or wanted you to get an embroidery machine?
Well, when you do projects and you sew and you want to put their name on it, well, it's kind of hard to hand do it by yourself on a freehand.
I cannot even imagine.
So I wanted, my sister had this machine and I like, well, that's really cool.
Uh-huh.
So I thought, and my other sister, she quilts a lot and she has the real big machines where she can do the blankets and everything. I said, well, my husband has this his work now, and he'd like to have little names on his t-shirts and the hats and everything. And so I got into quilting. I'm into it now, and this, I can do this without having to worry about not having their names on them.
So that's awesome. So you can customize any jacket or shirt or supposedly hat. We were talking about that earlier. How do you put that on the... So what you do is you take whatever it is, like with this. Tell me what you did. You had the hand towel, and then what?
Right. Well, you have to have the hand towel, and you have to put the backing on there. So it's a tearaway backing.
So let's look at it a little bit closer up here.
So there's a tearaway backing on there.
And that's what's making the white right now.
Right. And that should just wash off in the wash machine. And you figure out what size, because the machine will tell you after you punch in the design you want to put in there. It tells you what size you need. So I put that paper on there.
Do you have to iron it on, or you just
put
it on?
No, it's a sticky paper.
Okay.
So you just put that on there, and then you turn it over so that the threads don't come through it.
You mean from underneath?
From the towel.
Oh.
Because if you don't... There's that one button. So it'll help, because when you put that plastic on there, it helps prevent all the other threads from coming in there.
Yes.
Okay.
I can understand, because, that plush would just come right
and
through.
And so then you have to put in your machine.
Uh-huh.
Well, you have to
put
in
a
hoop. You have to put in the hoop. Yeah. And they have this one little gadget. It's called a snowman. And if you hoop it wrong, but if you have it even right, and then the center of it, and then it'll help center the straight. And there's a grid on there on the machine. There's like a little picture window. And you can just kind of make it straight.
That's an amazing machine.
Pushing buttons. It's an incredible machine.
So even if you have the fabric in crooked and the hoop in crooked, it will
The hoop always goes in straight, but if you have it hooped wrong, it'll still straighten it out.
I would appreciate something like that.
It's very nice.
Because I could imagine the frustration of getting it, the thing on the back, the plastic on the front, the hoop on, put it in the machine, take it out, and your
design's crooked. It's hard to sometimes. You have to make sure you get it nice and tight.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a trick to do that, too. So by the time you get the first and the second one in there.
There's always learning on every single project. But this is beautiful, and the fact that you could make the R so large. I think of my sewing machine, I have the ability to do just a few. You know, it's probably about that.
Well, now this is as small as I could get it. So, sometimes it'll go back because the machine has it only will go 20% smaller. So it's actually bigger. I made some for my friends for their birthdays, and that, like, I made the letter N for them and J. But
isn't that a great...
Now, some of the letters are bigger, and then I had to do another. Like, these I can get smaller.
Uh-huh.
And so these prints only get so much of a size, and you have this one that gets different sizes. So I couldn't make the whole Ricketts with this.
Right, because
you'd
need
such
a
large,
sheet bath towel.
Right, you would need a bath towel. That's right.
But I think
But they're all different sizes, and there's many, in the machine there's a lot of different patterns that you can use, but then you can download them from the computer too.
You can, so some come with the machine.
Yes.
Some you download.
Some you can purchase,
and then Nancy was telling me about one other crazy option.
Well, I haven't tried that one yet, but it has a tablet, and you can plug in the tablet, and then you could have your grandchild or whatever draw pictures on there, and then you can have that adjusted to put on your
machine. I know so many creative people who would just...
They would love that.
It's like the sky's the
limit. I'm just learning.
I never think about that.
Right now, I'm just learning. I'm going to start taking some more classes so I can learn how to work this machine.
Yeah. And it's not everyone who has a machine like this, but I know there are a few people in our area who do, and I don't know if they would be interested in taking in, because this is a great idea for a Christmas present. Everyone's going to use a hand towel.
Yes.
You could even... do embroidery for a special Christmas stocking.
Yes.
And the whole reason why Nancy started is to do
t-shirt. To put names on and different crafts.
Different crafts.
Different projects, blankets.
There's so many different ways that textiles touch my life, but I appreciate your flexibility. First of all, for making these, I love mine. I picked the dark, which brown and dirt will blend with so well with my three children. And thank you for being willing to come in and say hello to the community. I appreciate that.